big physical receiver, right? You know, he's about 6'4", you know, 220 pounds. Can really, you know, outman these physical cornerbacks in the NFL. But, you know, when you look at perspectives, right, when you have a guy like Antonio Brown making $14 million a year, and then Antonio Brown is making $3 million more. So you mean to tell me Alshon Jeffery with 2 touchdowns last year, you know, his numbers have been regressed over the past couple of years. You mean to tell me he's $3 million, you know, less than Antonio Brown, one of the greatest wide receivers, you know, that the game's ever seen? Mm-hmm. Your thoughts?
When are the Eagles going to get punished for making this decision? I mean, Alshon Jeffery, it's only 1 year. So if Alshon Jeffery hurts his hamstring again, then he's out of Philadelphia for good. And then they're back to square one. Jordan Matthews, by the way, the good news is that Jordan Matthews, I don't like to see guys lose their jobs, but Jordan Matthews is probably gone. You know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, if Alshon's healthy, they're going to have a good receiving core. It's going to come at a price. Connor Barwin had to leave. Ryan Matthews is going to have to leave. Kendricks is going to have to leave. Don't they have to relieve some cap space? They signed another guard today. They signed Torrey Smith today for a little more than Brandon Marshall. Their cap has to be getting towards the over, you know, when you look at the Philadelphia Eagles and their cap money. So they're going to have to cut some dudes. And you look at Jordan Matthews, though. I think Matthews will have a good season in the slot. Alshon Jeffery gets hurt a lot. So you look at Terrell Pryor and Brandon Cooks as other options. But I'll admit it, I'm a little scared of Alshon Jeffery in terms of his talent. I think that he is a guy that can go up and make plays, can make contested catches, one of the more athletic players in the NFL. I just think he's going to get hurt. I think it's only a one-year deal, and I think the Eagles are going to lose a lot on the defensive side, because when you pay $14 million for one player, don't you think that some of the defensive guys have to get cut, Matt?
Absolutely. When you have to bring a guy on like a one-year $14 million deal with Alshon Jeffery, yeah, you're going to have to cut guys. I mean, they did that with Connor Barwin today. And, you know, they're going to have to free up some guys to be able to free up cap space to be able to sign a marquee free agent like Alshon Jeffery. But, you know, granted, I know the Eagles have other needs, obviously, at defense with cornerback and safety. You know, their defense last year was, you know, pretty, you know, middle of the pack defense, gave up a lot of yards against the run, against the pass. But on the flip side, Carson Wentz needs that big time receiver. Nelson Aguilar has been an absolute bust ever since he came out of USC.
Yep.
two years ago. And when you look at a guy, Carson Wentz, who is the future of the franchise for the Philadelphia Eagles, he needs a big time playmaker, and they certainly got that with Alshon Jeffery. So the Eagles
did get a playmaker, but it makes Brandon Marshall look a heck of a lot better. And, you know, it's a one-year deal, so I guess if Alshon balls out, would you, you know, on this podcast, we come at it from a Giants point of view. I don't know. I kind of would like to see the Eagles, like, book him up for, like, overpay the crap out of Alshon Jeffery, kind of, and sign him, like, 6 years for, like, $12 million a year or something.
Mm-hmm.
That would be pretty sweet, wouldn't it? Because then they're stuck with Alshon Jeffery, like, if he doesn't pan out.
Well, I'd rather have the one-year deal, obviously, because he's only giving it a trial, and I'm afraid of Alshon Jeffery. I know.
So you want him gone after this year.
I know only put up 800 yards last year and 2 touchdowns with the Jets, but
he was hurt.
He's a scary receiver. You know, with Alshon Jeffery, he's 6'4", like I said, 220 pounds. But I'm also happy today as well, you know, that DeSean Jackson signed with the Buccaneers, because he was an absolute giant killer.
And we dodged a huge bullet with that,
and I'm very excited to be able to not have him in the same division.
It's interesting. DeSean Jackson, I'm not going to say he's like a Brandon Marshall, but he is kind of a diva wide receiver. So they're looking out for Carson Wentz here. Alshon's definitely not as flamboyant as DeSean Jackson is. And then you look at Torrey Smith. Torrey's a real pro, but again, he's like 28 years old. He's not going to do very much. I mean, he's going to sprinkle in a couple of big plays. I don't really see Torrey Smith doing too much. I think his best years are behind him. He's gotten hurt. He's played in San Fran. He was good on the Ravens. A one-dimensional player, not really that good of a player.
Mm-mm. And when you look at this other free agency, you know, we can certainly, you know, divert to all the different NFL
Let's
agency.
Let's just bounce the heck around.
I tell you,
like Reed Adam Schefter and Ian Rappaport.
I gotta tell you,
Twitter
time. The one big deal that struck me today, I don't know about you guys, how you guys feel, but I really am struck by this Brock Osweiler deal going to the Browns. And I know that the Browns have said they're looking at all options at quarterback. and they're doing the best that they can to be able to bring their best quarterback forward. I know they're going through a quarterback carousel, especially up in Cleveland, like they've always been up and since the Tim Couch days.
Right.
So when you look
DeLome, at Kelly Holcomb,
so when you look,
all these
when you look at the Browns being able to bring on this contract and be able to bring on a second rounder from Houston, Houston just wanted to dump him and said, here's a second rounder. It might hurt us down the line, but we're no longer in the, you know, in that line to be able to have, you know, that's this contract anymore. It's off the books now. So that now they can focus on potentially getting a guy like Tony Romo. I know that the Denver Broncos, the Houston Texans, and Dallas are in trade talks right now in a three-way trade to be able to move Tony Romo. I don't know what the structure of the trade is yet, but it's interesting. What would you rather – this is my question to you, Spence.
Sure.
Where would you rather see Tony Romo go for his, you know, latter part of his career? I know he's older than Eli. Mm. He's about 36, 37 years old.
Yeah.
So where would be the best fit, you know, going? Would it be the Denver Broncos right now or the Houston Texans? Your thoughts.
If I'm Tony Romo, right.
What would be the best decision for
if
Tony Romo?
If I'm Tony Romo, you want to replicate the career path that Peyton Manning went on. You saw what John Elway did with Peyton Manning in his latter years. You have Von Miller, DeMarcus Ware, you know, Aki Talib, you know, Darian Stewart, Chris Harris. You have Brandon Marshall, the other Brandon Marshall at linebacker. And then on the offensive side of the football, you have Demaryius Thomas and Emmanuel Sanders. You have veterans upon veterans upon veterans. You have John Elway, who is in there. He's a rock-solid general manager. That's a storied franchise and one that has just experienced the highest prize in all of sports just 2 years ago. They know how to win. You look at the Houston Texans. When you think about the Houston Texans and the definition of the Texans, you know what you think about? An expansion franchise. Bad quarterback play. Dave, you don't think about Derek Carr. You think about David Carr, how he just got beat Sunday after Sunday with no offensive line play. You think about an expansion franchise. You think about a team that has had a whole carousel of head coaches. Bill O'Brien was in there. You had Kubiak and Matt Schaub, teams that couldn't get over the hump. You do have a good defense, but you have Lamar Miller. You have DeAndre Hopkins. You have a bunch of players that have never experienced playoff football. It's Denver Broncos versus an expansion franchise in the Houston Texans. Elway's done this before with Peyton Manning, and you'd be foolish not to go to Denver. So I'm pretty sure that if you want to win a ring, you can go to Denver. The flip side of that question is if Tony wants to forge his own legacy and be a hero in Houston forever and stick it to the Dallas Cowboys, that's the option. But what is your take on the matter?
I think my take is definitely – not going to Denver, right? I understand that you can make a case going to Denver. John Elway did a great job for Peyton Manning, getting them the great supporting cast, and that's certainly a winning culture there. But look at the flip side of it. You have a guy, Bill O'Brien, he's been, you know, making that team. It's amazing that that team, you know, is still together after that quarterback carousel they went over the past, you know, 3 to 4 years when they had got, you know, Brock Osweiler and other guys like Tom Savage. And, you know, the list goes on and on. To be able to have that team, a divisional playoff team last year for how bad Brock Osweiler played. And, you know, obviously Tom Savage, you know, was a guy who just came in just for one game. But for the, how bad that quarterback play was to be able to bring them into the second round of the playoffs, I think that Bill O'Brien has great potential to be one of the, you know, one of the great coaches, especially in this league. I mean, when you have the Texans have a great supporting cast with that number one defense last year. They played so well, you know, with those boys with J.J. Watt, Jadeveon Clowney, you know, Jonathan Joseph. I just love those boys, how they play that style of defense. And the thing is, too, when you have on the offensive side, I think you have much better offensive players on that offensive side with DeAndre Hopkins and Lamar Miller. And you know, there's so many pieces around that Houston organization to be able to make that playoff run in the AFC, because I certainly think the Houston Texans are just one quarterback away from potentially beating New England Patriots, you know, in the AFC playoffs. Well, it's really close. The Broncos lost too many defensive players over the past couple years. I know you've had guys who went to – the one guy that went to Chicago, the one of the linebackers, and other guys going to Jacksonville.
Yeah, you're right.
And the thing the defense has not been the same ever since that Super Bowl
that
win
nose
they
tackle
had.
Tackle last year went to the Jacksonville Jaguars.
Right.
But you're – I mean, the cases are – you do make a good point because the AFC South right has the Titans and Mariota and them. They're still way
Mariota
too young.
Mariota is also coming off that injury as well with that ACL tear, so that's going to be a big cause of concern going into the third season.
You have no cornerbacks in Tennessee. Tennessee's not an elite team. If you were going to put Tennessee up against Kansas City and Reed, you're going to probably have a 10 or 11 win team next year.
Purgatory, Chiefs.
But not that easy to win the. If you're going to win a Super Bowl, you have to win your division first, or else you're going to have to sneak in on the wild card and play cold games away from home. And then you look at Jacksonville and David Caldwell and Doug Marrone, and I can't believe that Jacksonville's even. If the NFL had to eliminate a team, you know, like if they were like a soccer franchise that had to eliminate a team for bad play, it'd be Jacksonville. They're all dysfunctional, Blake Bortles and all these guys. They ain't doing crap next year. And then the last team you talk about is the Indianapolis Colts that just fired their GM, that don't really have pieces around Andrew Luck. Their defense is totally, totally just dismantled and so unorganized. And you go against Oakland, and Oakland's a juggernaut, a sleeping giant. Kansas City, and then you still have to play Phil Rivers in San Diego, so that's a good angle. And then you look at Vance Joseph. Is Vance Joseph going to be the best coach? Wade Phillips is gone. Wade Phillips is the defensive coordinator, I believe, for the LA Rams right now. So Wade Phillips is gone, and those are 2 points. But if you're Tony Romo, I just think you got to trust John Elway. You got to go to Denver and be with John Elway, because how do you know Bill O'Brien's a good football coach? I know he did okay with Christian Hackenberg, but this is the same organization that just, you know, it got embarrassed over Brock Osweiler and made one of the more hilarious trades we've ever seen today.
I understand, but outside of that, I know they made the big mistake of signing Osweiler
without even seeing him,
without even meeting him for the first time. And obviously, yeah, that's a big mistake on their part. They lost a second rounder in the following draft, in the 2018 draft.
Yeah.
But you know what? You live and learn, you move on. So I think the Houston organization has a lot to be proud of, you know, going to the second round. The year before that, they were in the first round and they lost. So I think they're making strides in the playoffs. These guys are getting playoff experience. So I think the Texans are one quarterback away, like I said, to making that next step to be able to potentially, you know, knock off the New England Patriots. I know the New England Patriots just signed, you know, a great cornerback again with Stephen Gilmore, you know, going to the Patriots for a multi-year deal.
I'm really
so I think
surprised
that's excited.
At that pick.
That's a good pickup for the Patriots. That's going to solidify their secondary. And, you know, another decision that is, I think it's really a boneheaded move, and I want to get your take on it. They're actually thinking about trading Malcolm Butler. You know, you remember him, right? Super Bowl 49, you know, basically the MVP taking away from Russell Wilson that interception at the goal line. Mm-hmm. They're actually thinking about negotiating a trade with the Saints to be able to get Brandon Cooks. I mean, I understand I love Brandon Cooks as a player. Tom Brady can make, you know, these guys even greater, like Derek Hogan, Wes Welker, and, you know, the list goes on and
on.
Yeah,
Welker, Amendola.
So why would you want to trade for a guy like
Edelman,
Brandon Cooks, for a guy who was basically the Super Bowl MVP, you know, 3 years ago? I just don't understand that move on their part. I think Malcolm Butler is a really good
corner. Let's list all the wide receivers that we could think of, like the New England wide receiver, the Welker, you had Edelman, Amendola, what other guys? I mean, I know you had LaFell, you had that guy this year who had pretty clutch catches down the stretch. The name escapes me, but here's the thing. The Saints, it's a great idea to sign Malcolm Butler. Now, Malcolm Butler's probably going to get paid a crap load of money. He's going to get paid so much money coming up pretty soon. So the Patriots now have Gilmore. Logan Ryan is out the door. The Patriots also have Eric Rowe that they sometimes throw around and Patrick Chung. You know, Matt Patricia, I usually trust the Patriots' judgment, but I've watched Stephon Gilmore play a lot of games for Buffalo, and this dude, even though he had a lot of interceptions, even though he's flashy, he's like an Asante Samuel. He makes some boneheaded holding penalties. He's a guy that gets beat a lot. He's a guy that drives Bills fans crazy because he just has potential, but he's never equaled his potential. He's holding. He's always making bonehead plays that cost them games and drives. So for New England to sign Gilmore, or say Gilmore got signed by like Jacksonville or the Bears, we'd all be saying, boy, they overpaid for like a corner that has a lot of holding issues. But it's the Patriots, so we give them a pass. I'm not a fan of signing Stephon Gilmore. And for the Saints, that would be a great move to sign Malcolm Butler, because that's actually showing that you're willing to invest in your defense. And Shanko, I know you have a point, but when you look at the NFL, look at the NFC South. Carolina had Cam Newton, right? And no one saw 15-1 Carolina coming 2 years ago. Atlanta with Matt Ryan, they just went 8-8, 6-10. Bam, they go 12-4 and are up 28-3 on the verge of a world championship. Look at Drew Brees. Could Drew Brees have this out-of-body MVP-type season with Sean Payton? Can they make one more run? Don't count them out. They're a team that can do it.
I understand where you're going from with that, with Atlanta being a team that went so far and Carolina being a team that, you know, certainly got caught our, you know, came out of a rabbit's hat and certainly went to the Super Bowl.
Yes.
But, you know, I think when you look at the New England Patriots, how many moves that they've made over the past couple days.
And cutting Darrell Revis. How about cutting Darrell Revis?
I have a really good question
for
you.
And then I have some more questions.
I was thinking about the New England Patriots. They always been signing these new guys. They're making a lot of moves. You know, I was thinking, are the New England Patriots the Golden State Warriors of the NFL? Because it seems like, you know, New England Patriots, it's always like, oh, they're always the GOAT. Tom Brady has won 5 Super Bowls. Could have been 7, you know, without the Giants, obviously. But, you know what I'm saying? They always win championships. They always have the good players. They always have Tom Brady. Everybody wants to go to New England. So, I guess, do you think that New England is like the Golden State of the NFL? Your thoughts?
No. Because when I look at the Golden State Warriors, they have Curry, Klay Thompson, and Kevin Durant. They have Curry and Kevin Durant. So when you look at the Patriots, they have Tom Brady, but then they have a hodgepodge of guys like Julian Edelman. Then they have a guy, Chris Hogan, got 230 yards in the AFC Championship game. He was in Miami on Hard Knocks and got cut, kind of like Wes Welker. He was a special teams player, a lacrosse player, for goodness sakes. So right. Yep. I look at the Patriots kind of more like the Cleveland Cavaliers, okay, where they have LeBron James and then they have a supporting cast around them. Because, you know, in New England, you do have like Malcolm Butler. Your defense, you have Hightower, who's a good player, you know, I believe as a linebacker. You had some good defensive linemen last year, right? You had Long there that made plays on third down for him. You'd have some defensive nose guards that made plays. I'd say they're more like Cleveland. I wanted to ask you today, there is a quarterback out of Tampa Bay, got signed for $15 million a year. We call him Necky on this show. Shout out to the Chris Vernon Show for that nickname. Long Neck, Mikey the Giraffe Glennon. $15 million man going to the Windy City in Chicago. Do you like the move for the Chicago Bears?
Well, I think it was might have been more than $15 million. It might have been maybe $19 million guaranteed. I might get that mixed up with somebody else.
I think it's like 3 years, $35 million.
45. I think it's a 45.
Let's see what we got. I could be wrong. I'm going down. We're going to see Terrell Pryor visiting the Redskins. It was a crazy day. Ooh, Luke Jokel to the Seattle Seahawks. Today was crazy, wasn't it? How crazy was it, man?
What an absolute crazy day. We're actually looking at Adam Schefter's Twitter page, you know, so he's certainly making moves.
Red Ellison is a Giant. I'm going to need to even look up who that dude is.
But, yeah, to address.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's so many great topics, but we got to do Glennon. Here we go. 3 years, $45 million.
That's what I said.
Hey, that's 15. I was right.
Yeah, $15 million a year. Is Mike Glennon worth $15 million a year?
Yeah, I got it right,
for a guy who does not have that much, you know, experience. I mean, it's pretty amazing when Brock Osweiler got $72 million last year. And for a guy, Mike Glennon, that did not even get that much playing time. I mean, yeah, Mike Glennon's like a pretty below average to average quarterback. But I don't see him as being, you know, the next messiah for the, you know, for the Chicago Bears. I mean, he's a guy who, you know, he's a good decision maker. He has a pretty decent arm. Mm-hmm. But, you know, yeah, I haven't seen too much from him. So I don't know if he can take that big load for him and being able to perform in a year-to-year basis and going 16 games. You know, this is going to be his first year, you know, playing a 16-game season. So it's kind of like a wait-and-see type of thing for him. So I'm wondering to see what types of opportunities he's going to get for Chicago. I wonder what, you know, what offensive players are going to surround him with. Since Alshon Jeffery was a huge loss for them. They lost Matt Forte 2 years ago.
Right.
So when you look at that, Mike Glennon needs offensive players in this upcoming draft
and
for the Chicago Bears.
And he needs them badly.
Because Mike Glennon's not going to put him over the top.
He's okay. I mean, he had Greg Schiano. You know, he started a lot the Schiano years. Then Lovie came in with Jameis. And now they have Dirk Cutter. And he basically got no playing time. But this dude he didn't do that well in preseason last year. He's 6'5", tall quarterback, kind of Nick Foles just in the way that he kind of goes about it.
You know what's pretty amazing? I'm just watching this now. Wide receiver Terrell Pryor visiting the Redskins? So you mean to tell me the Browns are going to let him walk after a great rookie season that he had? That's pretty mind-boggling.
Well,
to me.
And guess how much DeSean Jackson just made today? $11.6 million a year.
Wow.
And guess how much Brandon Marshall's worth to the Giants?
Six.
Amazing.
I got to tell you.
This deal gets better and better. $11.6 million. Let's look at how old DeSean Jackson is. His best years are way behind him. And I know he gets paired with Mike Evans. Is Vincent Jackson gone from there?
Yes.
Okay, where is he at now, Vince? Is he like retired right now? He's 30 years old, DeSean Jackson.
Yeah, but he came in the league 8 years ago. He had a great year last year. Had a 1,000-plus yard, you know, receiving last year.
With the Redskins?
Yes.
He also played with Sean McVay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's 34 years old, and he still says he's with Tampa Bay, actually, Vinny Jackson. But he's going to retire soon. Okay, so you have Evans and Jackson.
I tell you, what wide receiver tandem would you rather have?
Yeah.
Would you rather have the Giants tandem with Odell Beckham and Brandon Marshall or the Buccaneers with Mike Evans and DeSean Jackson?
Not even a question, not even a flinch. Okay?
Really?
Brandon Marshall is a stud in the red zone. I take Brandon Marshall over DeSean Jackson any day of the week, including Sundays, obviously. This is a dude that could jump up. He could snag footballs in the red zone. DeSean Jackson, he's a one-trick pony. He always has been all his career. He's just a speedster. He doesn't run over the middle of the field. Brandon Marshall's a do-everything type of player. And, again, I would rather have Brandon over DeSean. And then you look at Mike Evans. Mike Evans is a talent. Mike Evans doesn't have as much baggage.
Excellent. I agree with that, but you know, I'm going to go against you, obviously, because
I know
I'm a Giants fan through and through.
Me too.
But the thing is, I actually, not going to lie, I think the Mike Evans, DeSean Jackson could be certainly better, because when you look at a guy like Mike Evans, he's a 6'5 guy. He can certainly go up into the red zone. He's a much younger Brandon Marshall. I think Brandon Marshall is over the hump. I don't know if he has that same vibe that he used to have in his younger years. You know, he certainly had a down year, obviously, past year. So when you look at a guy like DeSean Jackson, I think he's got speed. He'll definitely beat Odell Beckham in a 40-yard dash. I think he's definitely a deep threat, you know, in the NFL when it talks about the deep ball. And I think Jameis Winston has that big talent arm to be able to get DeSean Jackson the ball and to be able to make great impact for your team. Because I think that, you know, for a big playmaking ability, DeSean Jackson has that big time play where you can get a 90 plus yard receiving yards, you know, for a touchdown. I'm not saying Odell Beckham can't, But the thing is with Odell, you have to deal with Odell Beckham's issues off the field,
yes,
with the net we've talked about from before, yeah, and his, you the know, Miami his trip, antics and the way he goes about his business.
The
and,
Josh Norman game I, 2 years ago was just yes. a freaking disaster. So such
rather,
an embarrassment.
I'd rather have a mature guy like DeSean Jackson and a younger Mike Evans to be able to compliment a guy yeah. like Jameis Winston younger in his career.
DeSean Jackson, when he was younger with the Eagles, you know, never got into trouble off the field. You know, the gang story about DeSean, like, not exactly true, but I did hear DeSean Jackson was sometimes he was not exactly the most vocal teammate to have, kind of selfish, not like incredibly mature and firm and professional at all times, but he's never hurt a fly. Neither has Odell Beckham. These two are actually pretty similar in their personalities, DeSean and Odell Beckham, but look at Odell Beckham. He's on pace to literally be like a Jerry Rice talent. 35 touchdowns over three seasons, okay? 4,122 yards, and the dude is just absolutely ridiculous. He is a flyer. He can take a 15-yard slant route and take it to the house. He can leap out of the gym. Did you watch that game this year, Giants versus the Baltimore Ravens? He single-handedly won that game. So much attention is drawn to Odell. To compare Odell and DeSean Jackson in the same sentence, I really
come on, man. I'm a Giants fan. I watch every Giants game this year. You're questioning a Giants
no,
fan
well,
himself?
No, I'm just sustaining my point that Odell Beckham, okay, is so much better than – he's better than Mike Evans. Pretty sure he's better. And then I'm going to take Brandon Marshall over DeSean Jackson. I am. Mm-hmm. And if so, I go Odell over DeSean. And then Brandon or Mike Evans, I don't think that there's that much of a difference. I really don't. So you can even argue Mike.
It's a fair argument.
You can even argue Brandon Marshall's just as good as Mike Evans. I think that DeSean for $12 million, you can find – I think Brandon Cooks you can get cheaper. Terrell Pryor has a lot of potential. You know, I think that that's a little too much money. I would have wanted DeSean for like $8 or $9 million. Mm-hmm. I think that DeSean got a great deal in Tampa Bay. I wanted to ask you here about this question, okay?
Go ahead.
We addressed Mike Glennon going to Chicago, and my opinions on Mike Glennon is that, you know, I think he's a good insurance guy. I wouldn't, like, you know, go all in on Mike Glennon. You don't really know what you have. I draft another quarterback and have them battle it out, and that's what Chicago's going to do. Or so if you're the Cleveland Browns, how much do you value Jimmy Garoppolo? And since you got this second-round pick today, you know Tom Brady's an old quarterback. New England would want that second-round pick.
It's not going to happen.
Are you making that move if you're the Cleveland Browns? Are you going for Jimmy Garoppolo?
There's no chance that it's going to happen because New England has openly stated that they're not trading Jimmy Garoppolo in the next coming years because they have a guy like Jimmy Garoppolo can still learn, obviously, from Tom Brady. I know he's been under the helm for 3-4 years now. I certainly think that Jimmy Garoppolo can be a starting quarterback in this league since there's a lot of teams in the NFL that can use, you know, especially NFL quarterbacks. I mean, there are even teams today even calling about Brock Osweiler the minute he was talking, you know, even got traded to the Browns. So that just tells me that teams are desperate for a starting quarterback.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, teams wanting Brock Osweiler. What have we come to?
Even if it's Brock Osweiler. That's right.
Brock Osweiler. The Houston Texans said to Cleveland, please, please take him off our hands. We'll give you a second-round pick, too, you know, to get rid of him. It was unbelievable. But you look also a crazy developing story right now from Adam Schefter is the Redskins president, Bruce Allen, has said comments. I believe we're going to get some by the owner of the Washington Redskins, Dan Snyder. Redskins GM Scott McCloughan. I don't know if I even said that right. Scott McCloughan, he's fired after two seasons. He was let go. He was missing from the facility for a week. Yeah. I don't know if he had family issues or if the Redskins were planning on letting him go. This is free agency, and they're firing their general manager right in the heat of free agency.
Well,
pretty unbelievable.
I did hear from a report that I think he's been going to have some alcohol problems, especially coming from him not being able to come from the facility.
Okay.
And that's something that obviously it's very cause for concern especially for the Redskins organization. Dan Snyder, in my opinion, is probably one of the worst owners in sports, obviously outside of James Dolan, obviously, the New York Knicks. But when you look at a guy like, I think he's a guy in the Redskins organization. You know, certainly Kirk Cousins is a quarterback who wants to get out of Dodge, and his trade request got denied, so he doesn't even want to stick around anymore. So for this Redskins organization?
You look at Washington, man, and I know that they just signed Norman to this crazy, crazy contract. I mean, that now the general manager's gone. Sean McVay is out of town. I'm not sure who the defensive coordinator is. Tom Sula's still there. They are completely
– yes.
I just think that they're so incompetent.
They're irrelevant. Irrelevant.
By the way, I've never said this years – go ahead.
But the thing – I'm seeing this right now. The Buccaneers gave Jaquise Rogers a 2-year $3.3 million? That's a steal.
That's dirt
Man,
cheap.
Man, that is dirt cheap for dirt a guy cheap. Like – Jaquise Rogers putting in so much hard work, you know, for the Buccaneers.
Seattle, Luke Jokel, 1 year, $8 million.
He was a great fantasy player last year for all you guys playing in the ESPN Flex Leagues last year. So
Russell Okung
has agreed to the Chargers with a $53 million deal.
Well, now you have Doug Martin, you have Dougie the Muscle Hamster, and now you have Jaquise Rogers. Luke Jokel, I like the pick. I like the upside. It's an $8 million deal. It's a one-year deal. Latavius Murray's visiting Seattle.
That's interesting.
Poverty of riches, because you have some good players. You don't have Christian Michael anymore. He got traded, but you still have Thomas Rawls.
That's really interesting.
They just seem like they're so similar. How about this one? Okay, Tony Jefferson, you know him from the Cardinals. He's a safety. He's now playing with Eric Weddle in Baltimore.
Mm.
Pretty damn good move by
Ozzie
Newsome.
There's your boy, Julius Thomas, on the move to the Dolphins.
Officially on the move.
Uh-huh. Staying in the Sunshine State.
Staying in the Sunshine State, going from Blake Bortles to Ryan Tannehill. Pray for Julius Thomas, man. If Julius Thomas found the right team, he'd be good. My question for you now is crazy news today all over the place. If you're the New York Giants, do you want a tight end like a O.J. Howard, or would you want the Giants to select
I want Ryan Ramczyk, baby. He is such a physical specimen.
Okay.
He's definitely a 6'6", 6'7", 300-plus yards. You need blockers. I understand that you got Brandon Marshall now, you know, a good wide receiver to put on the outside for in key red zone situations, but you need players for him. You need Eli. You need to block for Eli in his later part of his career to be able to keep him upright, because you don't know how long Eli's going to have left in his, you know, in his NFL career. And you just need that help on that offensive line. It's in such shambles. They have not dressed it, you know, in a couple drafts now. Eric Flowers is a complete bust, in my opinion. You know, he can do whatever he wants in the offseason now.
And he's
to be able
top,
to get better.
A
but
top 10 pick.
And that's what I'm
it's
saying.
It's crazy. When you draft a top 10 pick and you can't even sign him after 5 years, what a swing and a miss, Jerry.
But
swing and a miss, Jerry.
But Jerry Reese didn't swing and a miss when he picked Odell Beckham and Sterling Shepard and Landon Collins.
That's
so
true.
Big key
Odell.
Building blocks. Building blocks.
Yeah, but also Justin Pugh. I mean, he's not a lock either.
Justin Pugh is a pretty solidifiable guard at the left side.
He gets hurt a lot. He doesn't run block. I mean, Weston was a good pick.
What about Richburg in the second round one year?
That was a good snack.
Yes.
But you look at Larry Donnell. I mean, Larry Donnell wasn't selected by P.J. Goodson.
You mean Damon Snacks Harrison?
That was a good pick, but I'm talking about Darren Wilson. I don't know if his name's Darren Wilson, actually.
Darian Thompson.
Yeah, that's okay. But what about the guy out of Virginia Tech? He had to retire early. Andre Williams, a fourth-rounder.
David Wilson. Such a shame.
These fourth-rounders haven't been that good, though. If you look back to Jerry Reese's time, he picked this North Carolina linebacker, wasn't that good.
You need linebackers, though, to be able to solidify that line with the Jonathan Casillas.
Yes.
You know, maybe Kelvin Shepard on the right side. Being able to put in a Devin Kennard, obviously, pretty average to above-average linebacker.
Sure.
You know, for that leader of that defense, you need players to be able to solidify
the
linebacker
during
position.
This last segment. Mm-hmm. I want to do Row the Boat segment, but I want to talk about how this quarterback class coming up. I love Deshaun Watson. I love Deshaun Kizer, and I love Davis Webb. I think this is going to be like the 2004 draft class. Every year,
Guess what all the pundits say? This class is a weak quarterback class. This class is a weak quarterback class. Every year, right, Shanko?
Yep.
Why not draft Deshaun Watson? You know what I'm saying? Like, why is this – why is the buzz not going around Deshaun Watson? Why is he free-falling from grace?
I love Deshaun Watson. I will do anything in the ends of the earth to have him walk to the New York Giants because obviously if they didn't, if the Giants did not have the offensive – if they didn't have the quarterback, obviously, which they still do, and they needed offensive – if they didn't need offensive line help, I would pick Deshaun Watson.
Guess what? If Watson is there –
I think he's going to be such a special talent in this league. He played so well. You know, he knows what it's like to win. Mm-hmm. He knows what it's like to lose. He has that big –
he doesn't know what it's like to lose, man. Yes, 33 and 3.
Yes, he does. He lost to Alabama, remember? You're right. Against Clemson.
He lost one time. He lost only three times in his college career to overcome adversity.
He has that big time college football playoff experience. So I know, I understand that Mitch Trubisky, he has the arm, and you know, I remember watching Mitch. It was either Mitch Trubisky or Deshaun Kizer. I think it was Deshaun Kizer. He couldn't even hit a side of a brick barn, you know, watching that NFL combine last week because he was so inaccurate with these receivers.
He ripped your heart out, Temple guy.
I know. Well, yes, he did. But, you know, I just think a guy like Deshaun Kizer is – he's going to be, you know, he might be another Andy Dalton, but you never know.
No way. I'm making that prediction right now. These guys are all strong-armed quarterback. Mitch Trubisky is bust all over the place. He's Matt Schaub.
Yeah, well, he can't Mike throw Glennon the football has a strong downfield. Arm. That's what the Chicago Bears think.
I know. And now the thing is, though, but the thing about all these guys is not only do they have good arm strength, they are also mobile. Deshaun and Deshaun Kizer. It's Deshaun Kizer, right? We have two Deshauns, which is pretty crazy. Mm-hmm. Deshaun and Deshaun. I think Davis Webb out of Cal, though, this guy is going to be the next. Oh, gosh, I don't want to say it.
You know what?
But Davis Webb, by the way, he's going to win multiple Super Bowls, first ballot Hall of Famer. He's going to be one of the greats of all time. I might take Davis Webb over all of these guys.
You know who else is a dark horse in this draft, quarterback perspective?
Who?
I like Kaya, the Miami quarterback.
Brad Kaya?
Yeah. I like his arm strength.
Why not Davis Webb?
Accuracy.
Why not Davis Webb?
Why not Kaya?
Because Kaya doesn't have an incredible arm. He's a little frail, a little fragile. He doesn't
That's what they said about Russell Wilson.
But Kaya doesn't
that's
have
what they said about
Kaya
Doug
doesn't
Flutie.
Have incredible leadership though. Miami never won games with him. I mean, they won a couple.
Kaya, they have the supporting cast.
Dude, Davis Webb is an incredible leader. Deshaun Kizer and Deshaun Watson are all next level minds.
Do you think that Marcus Mariota who do you think is a better leader then? Marcus Mariota or Jameis Winston?
Great question.
Because when you look at leaders, right, and you bring up Marcus Mariota, I know he's a quiet guy in the locker room.
Yes.
So it's different when you look at a guy like he's not going to be able to pump up guys maybe outside of Jameis Winston because Jameis Winston's a guy who has all fire mentality, and I feel like Kaya could have that potential
he's
to be
so
that
quiet.
Same.
I mean, when you look
at—I'm kidding.
You look at Jameis Winston, like it's not popular to ever say anything good about Winston because you look at because a lot of people want to bring up like his alleged rape case and act like that's true. I don't know if it's true or not true, or how he yelled like the P word on top of a lunch table, or stole crab legs, or how he told like a bunch of sixth graders or something that women need to be quiet. We can all look at the tabloids, but Jameis Winston is an alpha male in the locker room, and I mean that because the dude is so confident. I've covered an athlete or watched an athlete that's so confident in what he does and have such a joy for life than Jameis Winston. He's a guy that'll go up to the veteran. He's almost naive in the way he leads because he doesn't care who it is. He just thinks he's the best guy in the room. He thinks he's meant to lead. And the guy is so vocal all the time. So Jameis Winston, I think, that's how I prefer my leaders to be, are loud, vocal, in your face. But Marcus Mariota, hard worker, does his job well, salt of the earth guy, nicest guy ever. Huge fan of both guys. Marcus Mariota, oh my gosh, he's like a best, he's like he'd be your best man at your wedding type of quality of guy. So you can't insult Marcus Mariota. He's a great, wonderful person, but I'd probably say Jameis Winston's a better leader in the locker room. I think this draft class is unbelievable.
So this quarterback class could be one of the, you know, even said one of the greats of all time.
I think
just
it's
like
gonna be
2004
incredible.
Draft.
Everyone says this
That's
draft
a reach.
Sucks. Everyone
That's a reach.
Says this draft sucks. This draft is gonna be fantastic. Okay. Patrick Mahomes and Trubisky are bust, but I love the three guys I mentioned, and you love some of the guys you mentioned as well. I wanted to get a couple more points in for you, okay? Or do you have a question for me?
I have no more questions for you, man. Any more comments about the NFL free agency today?
Yes. If you're Doug Whaley, you didn't make any moves really at all. You're the Buffalo.
It's only the first day.
You're the Buffalo Bills. You're the 10th pick in the draft. Are you drafting Corey Davis, a wide receiver? Are you drafting Zay Jones, your wide receivers coach, Scott McLaughlin, coached him at Eastern Carolina? Are you drafting a receiver in the second or third round to pair with Sammy Watkins, to pair with Robert Woods? You just paid Tyrod Taylor, which, again.
Restructured contract.
Or are you drafting a quarterback? What are you doing if you're the Buffalo Bills, and which quarterback do you want in Cleveland, okay? We'll give you San Fran, Cleveland, and Buffalo. Quarterbacks and direction. Can you please give us those answers?
What the quarterbacks are? What quarterbacks going to
yeah,
go to which
yeah,
team?
If you were the GMs of those teams, what would you? Man. How would you set that up?
Well, if I'm Kyle Shanahan and I'm the 49ers, obviously signing Brian Hoyer is not going to be your messiah in your future. So let's just put that to bed right now.
He's the anti-messiah.
So when you look at a guy, you know, Kyle Shanahan coming from. You know, obviously Matt Ryan's offense. So you want a guy who's got a big arm, you know, similar to Matt Ryan's talent. So honestly, I would love to be able to bring in a guy in the draft to be able to mentor, because Colin Kaepernick, this turned out to be an absolute bust for that organization. I know he had, you know, one or two good years, you know, under the Harbaugh era. So now when they make that transition now, they're starting to rebuild now. Jed York and that organization's going to have to rebuild. I'm not really sure where they're going to go at quarterback. I know there were talks about bringing Kirk Cousins in, but obviously that has been diminished since the trade request from the Redskins was denied. So I'm not really sure who the 49ers are going to have starting quarterback for the 2017 season. So what are other teams that you said that needed quarterbacks? You said the Browns?
Browns and Bills.
All right, the Browns, I really see somebody.
And then we're doing row the boat.
And I don't know. You're putting me on the
spot. Deshaun Watson.
I would love for the Browns.
They're
to
the
be
first
able to get,
pick. First pick, man.
I would love for the Browns to get a Deshaun Watson.
It's Deshaun Watson.
But the problem is,
it's Deshaun Watson.
They're going to probably go after the guy Myles Garrett because he's a physical specimen. They need passing rush.
He doesn't even want to play there, man. Defense, he said he wants to play in Dallas.
Defense
already.
Wins championships. I don't care. You're in the NFL draft. You get drafted wherever you are drafted. What? You're going to draft because I don't want to play for this organization.
You don't have a quarterback. Well, you need a quarterback
unless
to compete.
Unless if it's the San Diego Chargers.
Deshaun Watson is as good as. I'm tired of all the Sam Darnold hype. I mean, I know the guy could be successful.
I love Sam Darnold.
I know.
He's so good. I would pick. He is the. If he came out this year, I know he's too early to come out, but if he came out this year, he is definitely right behind Deshaun Watson.
Would you take Deshaun or Sam? A lot of people would take Darnold over Deshaun Watson. I'd say the majority
honestly,
of the listeners would.
I would take Darnold.
Okay.
I would.
I maybe
absolutely.
Would, too. The guy's an assassin. How about that
you,
throw?
Watching him in that Rose Bowl was absolutely fantastic, spectacular. He even threw balls off of his left foot, you know, his back foot,
yeah.
In the back of the end zone, and they were pitch perfect. You couldn't throw those footballs better than anybody out there.
Yes.
Then, what's his name?
Then
Darnold.
Darnold.
Sammy Darnold.
Well, you look at the Trojans, too, Adoree Jackson and Juju Schuster. You think those two could do well? Juju on that beat.
Yep.
Oh, man.
I think it's that time. It's that time of the week.
It's that time of the week. Everybody have stayed with us long enough. It is time for the Row the Boat segment of the week on the Shake and Spend Show.
I tell you, man, I actually want to start off this week because
let it all out.
It's been a wild couple of months with everything and the new year, and obviously I'm a new college graduate, certainly trying to obviously find a full-time job, obviously, coming out of college. I know we do this as a side gig for fun, but, you know, obviously.
Hopefully not for fun. Sponsor our show.
But, you know, it's something that, you know, I've been going on so many interviews now, and it's been such a whirlwind. A lot of these employers, they tell me that, you know, you just don't have the experience for this entry-level position. They're going to go with another guy who's more qualified. I've been doing this months and months and months. And to be able to keep going and having that perseverance and having that mentality of I'm never going to quit. You know, I'm going to keep getting 1,000 no's before I get that one yes, because once I get that one yes, it's going to be so worth it. You know, I'm going to keep, you know, anybody that's going through that problem right now, being unemployed, you know, it's so hard because you need some people out there need to support a family. They need to do, you know, go above and beyond in working 3 jobs. And I know some lives are miserable because of that, but you know, there is a light at the end of the tunnel, guys, and girls and ladies and everybody that's out there, because I really believe if you keep fighting for what you believe in, you know, keep, you know, going on these interviews, because one of these interviews is going to, you know, be that winner for you. And you just have that, you just can't quit, because if you quit now, you know, you're never going to be able to forgive yourself, you know, 10, 15 years down the line. And you want to be a somebody, right? You want to be that person that always makes yourself and around you better. And that's either by reading, you know, books, as I've been reading books about Mark Cuban, about his successes as a young entrepreneur. I would love to be able to become a young entrepreneur like him, to be able to start my own business someday. So I have those, you know, career goals and aspirations, and I would like to be able to have that someday, just like Mark Cuban, because he is a guy, role model that I look up to. And it's always important to have that role model, to look up somebody, to be able to have that mentality of that winner's mentality. And I just, for that row the boat session this week, as our mantra this week, don't quit. I know it's going to be hard going, you know, whatever respective situation you're going through right now, there is a light at the end of the tunnel, and whatever situation you're going through, you're going to get through it. And, you know, I will certainly get through it. And, you know, everybody that's going on that job hunt, you know, you'll eventually get through it. So, you know, you just got to keep fighting and working hard and really just focusing on being you.
Killed it again. I'm going to say some faults on that too on the row the boat segment of the week this week. You know, sometimes when you look at this world, a lot of times you can say that this world's kind of unfair, that everything's pitted against me, that, you know, I'm not getting what I want and what I deserve for the time that I've put in. And it's so frustrating a lot, because you go on these job interviews and they say you need more experience. You need more experience. And then you're like, well, I want the experience right where I'm asking for a job at your place. The thing is that makes life so special is once you eclipse that, once you get that job, you're in the upper echelon and you've made it and you know how hard you've worked. And that journey is what makes life so special. And that adversity in those times makes you a lot stronger and prepares you for adversity later in your life. And it reminds me of a couple of things, of a couple of analogies we can use to help people out. 28-3, Julian Edelman said to Tom Brady after they felt all that adversity, this is going to be a heck of a story. And for the people that get their first job opportunity or have the connections and get their foot in the door, they've never met that adversity. Their journey isn't as successful. Their life isn't as meaningful as people that have had those challenges. And it's going to be a heck of a story when you come back from 28-3. And it's going to be a heck of a story for those people who passed on you when they see you successful and you can go back, look them in the eye and smile and say, you know what? You could have had your chance right there, but you swing and you missed. And another portion of the Row the Boat segment of the week is, you know, Dak Prescott drafted in the 4th round and a guy like a Blake Bortles that doesn't have any adversity. So the point is like, I sometimes think, like, looking at everything in the job market, I think it is a dog-eat-dog business. It's very unequal.
okay? You're going to get knocked down a lot. But I think it's so special that once you start to make that money, once you start to become successful, I think it's very important, actually, that we have those layers. Because once you reach that pinnacle and once you continue to work and get yourself in that position to reach that pinnacle, then you don't want everybody from the bottom not working and immediately getting the elevator to that pinnacle. That's what I'm saying. Other people deserve to have these challenges as well. And other people, it's supposed to be a hard game. That's what I think what allures us to the game. You know, the reason why we go out and try to get the hottest girl, partly because she's hot, but also because, Shanko, it's the hardest thing in the room, and we want to be elite. We want to be the chosen one. And that's why it's so damn inspiring when you look at yourself and you look at the struggle, because you know that once you become elite, once you know you keep building and building, you'll know how special and how hard the road was to become one of those few special people that can actually make it in this world.
I couldn't even said it better myself, Spencer, and
you can disagree with the Row the Boat segment of the week, by the way.
I just think it's very, very thing this week that we were talking about.
And the
about.
Thing is,
it's
you
so
got
to
have a skill. Like, let's talk about
it's
getting
so
a job.
Important.
You got to have
it's
a
so
skill.
Important.
You got to be specific, right, in what you want.
Right.
And you got to have a skill that you bring to the table that no one can take away from you.
Yeah, and it's just really difficult. The job market, I know that, you know, Donald Trump even said in office that he was going to bring more jobs back, and he has, you know, in his first 100 days, and, you know, hopefully, you know, I wish him the best of luck in office, but, you know, to turn it back to our Row the Boat segment, I just think that, you know, that job offer, whatever it takes to get your foot in the door somewhere, it might not be your future job, it might not be a job that you like, but at least you're getting cash flow coming in. And, you know,
yeah.
Just like
wherever you first
just
end
like
up
the
at
guy
first,
from,
it's probably not going to be your last.
Just like the guy from Shark Tank. I like cash flow. It comes off the tongue. Cash flow.
I like Mark Cuban, too. He's such a confident dude. You know?
Oh, yeah.
Dude.
O'Leary.
Oh, yeah.
Kevin O'Leary.
Mr. Wonderful.
That's right.
Well, the thing is, Shanko, like, I kind of like this dog-eat-dog world, because once you get to the top of the mountain, man, it is a heck of a place. And it really separates the great ones from the average ones. You go to a lot of workplaces, and you'll see a 30-year-old guy, right? And he has a job, and he'll be emotionless, and you'll be like, I just have more fire than this guy. I have more power and more energy and more drive. It's about energy. It's about drive.
About success.
That's real. You have to love what you do, and that's why
success.
This podcast, I'm always looking for ways to improve this podcast, even though this might not be the biggest podcast, always looking for ways to improve, and that drive is what keeps us going as humans, man, that work, and we talk a lot about girls and you know, how tough it is sometimes to go out and meet right women and meet pretty girls. You got to control what you can control. You know, you got to work out. You just got the fresh cut. Got to try to get
Thank
a job.
You.
Got to do what you can control, man.
Yeah.
In life, you got to do what you can control.
You can't focus, you know, like in that Row the Boat segment.
On what you
especially,
don't have.
You can't focus on the past because you can't change it. And you're rowing to the future. You don't know what the future has, you know, in store.
Yep,
you're just rowing.
Back to the future.
You're just rowing, baby.
Oh, my God. On the path to being elite, failing is growth. That's such a great saying. Because, like, say you go up to a group of girls and they're not that friendly to you, not very receptive.
Nope.
You can either look back on that experience and say, what did I do wrong? Or you could just say, I grew today.
Yeah.
And I matured today.
Wait, what's that saying? You rather go up to bat than not go to bat at all.
Exactly.
So you're out there, you're winning, and you're doing the great things to be successful. And, you know, obviously going through hardships is what shapes people, right? And having go through hardships, you know, it certainly forms you to be a successful person in whatever field you go into.
Nail me 10.
Marketing, advertising, you know, engineering, medical, you know, whatever field you want to go into, right? You have to understand that you have to put that hard work in first to be able to make that successful
stride
in the future.
You have to treat people
with respect, because you never know where those people are going to be in the future.
Mm-hmm.
You know, man.
Absolutely.
You got to treat people the right way. You got to do things the right way. Be a friendly guy. You can joke around, heck yeah, but, you know, have a good heart on yourself. And anyway, guys, it's been a whirlwind. It's been so much fun. Free agent day, Shanko, and the NCAA tournament. It's a poverty of riches today. It's so much fun. How much fun is free agent? I think it's even better than the draft.
And even Sunday. I don't know about – well, the NFL draft is really great.
But I think Selection Sunday. We got to do a freaking live show Sunday.
We're doing a live show Sunday for the viewers,
pay
baby.
Attention.
I was just about to say, you took my line.
What?
I was going to say the Selection Sunday for this Sunday. We got a lot of – stuff going on. Got Selection Sunday. Next Thursday, we got, you know, the NCAA tournament. So we got a lot to discuss.
Dude, baby.
Right here on Shank and Spence.
Play hooky. Stay in school, kids. But watch the tournament, too.
That's going to do it for us on the Shank and Spence show today. I really appreciate you guys hanging with us today. If you like what you heard, subscribe to us.
Click that like button right in your right-hand corner of the show.
That's right. And to be able to do that, that's all you got to do. And I appreciate you guys hanging with us today. And I'll see you guys next time.
Sky, you ma, and row the boat.